Okay, sorry.
Thank you. About nonlinear Schrödinger equations, it's one of the most examples, one of the most known examples to which the theory applies, and one of the most simple, I think so. So I will use both slides and the blackboard, and now let me introduce some notation. I will put them on the blackboard. Let's take the dimension t more than or equal to 2 and consider the torus of the dimension d with period L. So this is Rd factor L times Zd. And here L will be a large parameter, and further it will go to infinity. So the size of our domain of the torus goes to infinity. Let me note that, of course, volume of this torus is L to the power d. So let me consider a function, complex function, on this torus. And I will denote by such norm just the L2 norm of this function normalized over the volume of the torus. So L to the power minus d integral over tdl absolute value of the function squared dx. So this is just L2 norm normalized per volume. Also, I will write my functions on the torus. I will develop them in the Fourier series. And I will choose convenient normalization. Namely, I will have factor L to the power minus d over 2. And then just the Fourier series. So I take a sum over S from ZDL. Yeah, what is ZDL? ZDL, this is just lattice ZD divided over L. So when L grows, my lattice becomes more and more frequent. Here I have space of the size L minus 1. So I take a sum over this space, over ZDL. Then the Fourier coefficients Vs and e to the power 2 pi imaginary unit S times x. S times x. So why this normalization is convenient? It's easy to see. Sorry, here this is squared norm, of course. Why this normalization is convenient? It's easy to see by applying the Parseval identity. Then I can write the L2 norm in the following form. Here we'll have due to this factor L to the power minus d, and then the sum over all s from my lattice ZDL with step L to the power minus 1, absolute value of the Fourier coefficients squared. So you see, when L will go to infinity, this lattice become more and more frequent, and it will be convenient to approximate sums of these forms by integrals over Rd, when we will redefine appropriately the function, the Fourier coefficients Vs to Rd from the lattice. So that's why this normalization is convenient. Okay, so now let me explain what is written here. This is just a nonlinear Schrödinger equation with cubic nonlinearity, where nonlinearity is slightly modified, so I subtract this normalized L2 norm. And also, I have a small parameter nu, which will go to zero, then we will send it to zero. And our equation is on our torus, which size of which will grow. So this modification of nonlinearity is rather innocent. It's quite frequently used by people working on Hamiltonian PDEs because it keeps the main features of the equation but reduces some non-critical technicalities. And also, let me note that if you consider such function u prime, which equals to e to the power et L2 norm of U squared times U, where U is the solution of my Schrödinger equation, then this function will satisfy just usual Schrödinger equation without this modification. So it's indeed rather innocent modification. Our equation is Hamiltonian equation. It preserves, as a usual Schrödinger, the L2 norm. The L2 norm. Let me write it down. So I will erase this, but instead I will write that the L2 norm is preserved. And the objective of the wave turbulence is to study solutions of this equation under the limit, which below I will call lim, when nu goes to zero, so the nonlinearity goes to zero, and the period L goes to infinity. So this is called lim. Nu goes to zero, and L goes to infinity. The meaning of this limit is not quite clear in the sense that we can, in general, this limit is not commutative. So let me mention some existing results. The limit when nu goes to zero, but the size of the torus L is fixed, it's treated in a number of publications. For example, in this one of Juan Guang, Sergei Kuksin, and Alberto Maiocchi. But this is far from the wave turbulence, because L is fixed. Due to our knowledge, the only mathematical works addressing this limit, when nu goes to zero, L goes to infinity, is these two works, one of 2016, another one is just recent. It was just published several days before we put on archive our work. In the first one, L goes to infinity quite slow, so it goes to infinity much slower than nonlinearity goes to zero, in the sense that L goes to infinity much slower than nu to the power minus one. And the results of this work are far from the prediction of the wave turbulence, and this is more a kind of averaging. The results of this work, they are more in spirit of the wave turbulence. However, they hold only for relatively short time interval, and this is also more a kind of averaging. So still, as I have mentioned, there are plenty of physical works that contain some different but still consistent approach to treatment of this limit, and none of them were rigorously justified, despite the interest in mathematical community. So in these works, physicists usually speak about pumping the energy to low modes and dissipating it in high modes. But in their level of rigor, these words do not have trace in the equation. And to make this rigorous, Zakharov and L'vov in 75, they suggested to consider the NLS equation dumped by viscosity and driven by random force. So random force make pumping the energy to low modes, and dumping the viscosity takes away energy from high modes. So, and that's what we are going to do. To explain this, it's convenient to write our equation in the slow time. So I set tau equal to nu t, and then my equation takes such form. So in front of the nonlinearity, we do not have small parameter, but we have such fast rotating term. And from now on, by dot, I denote the derivative with respect to this slow time. I will work only in this slow time. So now we consider the following equation. So we have the same NLS equation written in the slow time. I have additional parameter rho. Here I will comment in a few moments what is this. On the right-hand side, we put viscosity if R star equals to 1, this is just viscosity. If R star is larger, then this is hyperviscosity. And eta dot, this is a random noise. So I will explain what is this random noise. But before, let me comment on the scaling of parameters. You see, if I rewrite this equation back in the usual time, not in the slow, but in the usual time, I will get, again, small parameter nu here, and I'll get also nu here. So it means that our perturbation, this perturbation is weak. But it isn't clear at all why it should be of the same size, that nonlinearity. That's why we put here some scaling parameter rho, which is positive, and we will scale it with nu in such a way that the limit we are looking for exists. And let me mention that, in fact, rho will be not small but large parameter. It means that nonlinearity is much stronger than our perturbation of the system. So about rho star, we will assume only that it's just positive. What is about the noise? The noise is given by its Fourier series. You see here I have the same scaling parameter L to the power minus D like here. Then the Fourier coefficients are BS times beta S. BS are just some real numbers, but they obtained as a restriction of Schwarz function to my lattice. So in particular, these coefficients are fast decaying. So it means that I pump the energy mostly in low modes, but in high modes, the pumping is quite weak. And these are standard complex independent Wiener processes. That is each BTS obtained as some beta S1 plus imaginary unit beta S2, where beta S1 and beta S2 are standard real independent Wiener processes. So, yes. We can write the balance of energy of this equation, and then we'll find that the averaged energy per volume, what is this average energy per volume? For example, this quantity expectation of the L2 norm, I recall that my L2 norm is normalized over the volume, is of order 1, uniformly in all my parameters. So it means that the scaling which we have chosen is correct. About this equation, yes, I should mention that if rho star is sufficiently large, it is well posed, and also it's known that this equation is mixing. So there is unique stationary measure, and there is convergence to this stationary measure. And we are interested in the limit when nu goes to 0 and L goes to infinity in this equation. Yeah, I'll call it DD NLS because it's damped driven NLS equation. And we specify this limit by the following two possibilities. So the first possibility, I'll write it down. The second, I will not write on the blackboard. L is more than or equal to nu to the power minus 2 minus delta. Delta is positive. So you see that L goes to infinity sufficiently fast. We just find this precise meaning of this relation. I mean that the precise power just during our computations. Or the first possibility, just first L goes to infinity, first the size of the torus goes to infinity, and then the nonlinearity goes to 0. So we'll write our equation in the Fourier space. So I write the corresponding equation to the coefficients of the Fourier series. Let me write it down on the blackboard. It has the form ds dot minus e nu to the power minus 1 absolute value of s squared vs. So this is the input of my this fast rotating Laplacian. Then we have input of viscosity plus gamma s vs. So this is the viscosity. And gamma s here is 1 plus squared absolute value of s to the power r star. Then on the right-hand side, we have nonlinearity e rho l to the power minus d, sum over s1, s2, s3 from z dl, vs1, vs2, vs3 bar, and then the noise, plus bs, bts dot. So you see that due to the definition of the noise in the Fourier series, we obtain that it's just diagonal. Yeah, I forgot this delta prime 1, 2, 3, s. And what is this is delta prime? This is 1 if s1 plus s2 equals to s3 plus s. This is 0 otherwise. And if it would be just like this, then it would be natural to denote this just by delta 1, 2, 3, s. This is just common notation. But we have additional restriction that the set s1, s2 does not coincide with the set s3, s. And this restriction comes from the fact that we modified our nonlinearity. So somehow we subtract from the nonlinearity integrable term, which poses some technical problems. So, and we will work only in the Fourier representation. So I will forget about the initial equation. I will look only at this equation. What are we interested in? The central object in the wave turbulence is a so-called energy spectrum, which is in red in the blackboard. Energy spectrum, this is, we denote it by ns of tau. This is the expectation of the squared absolute value of the amplitude of the Fourier coefficient number s. And the objective of the wave turbulence is to study behavior of this energy spectrum under the limit nu goes to 0, l goes to infinity. So you see, people do not interested in the behavior of solution itself because most probably in the equation, we cannot take this limit. But what are people interested in such an observable? So let me make a small comment. Why is it so, and what does it mean? Look, we know that our equation, if we switch off the noise and the viscosity, we know that our equation preserves the L2 norm. So particularly, it preserves the sum of these squared amplitudes because of the Parseval identity. But of course, it doesn't mean that each of these Vs squared is conserved. Just their sum is conserved. Then we turn on the damping and the noise. And we are doing the following. Just to make a picture for a moment, let me assume that everything is dependent only on absolute value of s, not on s itself. And then we have damping and, sorry, we have injection of energy by the noise. And it mostly acts on low modes. Injection of energy. We have damping, which mostly acts on high modes. Actually, why? Because as I already told, BS, they are fast decaying. So we have stochastic perturbation mostly in, have injection of energy mostly in low modes. But on the contrary, gamma S, which is our viscosity, is large for high S. So in particular, then it's natural to expect that we have some flow of energy from high modes to low modes, which is the function NS in which we are interested in. So when the question is how this function behaves when nonlinearity goes to zero and the size of the system goes to infinity. This question morally is related to what about Jean-Pierre Ekman was talking, because he had a chain of oscillators. He had high energy in first oscillator, then he had damping in the last oscillator, and he was looking how the energy propagates through the chain. So morally, somehow these questions are related, but in our case, but of course the problems are very different. And here we're interested in much more like quantitative questions, because the goal of the wave turbulence, one of the main goals, is to show that under these limits, the energy spectrum satisfies so-called wave kinetic equation. Wave kinetic equation is an equation of such form. This is closed equation for the energy spectrum. So NS dot equals to some operator, which is called wave kinetic integral. This is an integral operator of N. Later, I will write it down, plus some term which comes from the viscosity, plus some term which comes from the noise. And here already S belongs to RD, not to ZDL, because we have taken the limit L to infinity. So you see this equation is a closed equation for the energy spectrum. In particular, we do not see any trace of arguments of VS. I mean that each VS is a complex number, so it has absolute value and argument. And here we have trace. Why don't I talk? We have trace only of absolute value. So somehow under this limit, all the angles should average out. And this is quite usual type of questions is in statistical mechanics, to find under some limits, to find a closed equation on some macroscopic observables like the energy spectrum. Okay. So now what are we doing? For the moment, there is no model for which this convergence would be justified of the energy spectrum to the solution of the kinetic equation. And what we are doing here? So we take the initial conditions such that at some negative moment of time, our system is at rest. This is just technical condition. It's simpler to work with because, I mean, anyway, it's quite technical and this assumption is quite natural. If t equals to infinity, it means that at minus infinity we were at rest. It means that due to the mixing property that now we are in stationary regime. Then we write our solution of our equation as a formal series in rho. I recall that rho is this parameter in front of nonlinearity. Yeah, I have it here on the blackboard. And then we take only quadratic part, only quadratic truncation of the series. So we take terms till the second one and call this object quasi-solution. Let me write it down. So we have formal series Vs equals to Vs0 plus Vs1, sorry, plus rho Vs1 plus rho squared Vs2 plus et cetera. And we throw away the rest of this formal series, the tail of formal series, and denote this object V large S and call it quasi-solution. And we will study instead of the real energy spectrum, instead of the energy spectrum of the solution itself, we will study the energy spectrum of this quasi-solution. And we will denote it by ns large. So actually, this is exactly what physicists do, because they always try that they study the solution, but in reality, they make such type of formal decomposition, and they throw away exactly terms starting from the fourth one in this series. So our first goal is try just to make rigorously what physicists do in a not rigorous way. The second goal will be to study the higher order terms of this formal decomposition. Of course, we hope to prove that this quasi solution is somehow close to our solution. But for the moment, we cannot do this. I will comment on this later. So now, as I already told, we study the energy spectrum corresponding to the quasi solution. And our goal is to show that under our limits, L to infinity, nu to zero, to show that approximately this energy spectrum satisfies the wave kinetic equation. So since here I have the truncation till the order rho squared, in the energy spectrum I will have truncation till the order rho to the power 4. And for the further need, let me write it down on the blackboard. So ns0 plus rho ns1 plus rho squared ns2 plus rho to the power 3 ns3 plus rho to the power 4 ns4. And now our goal, before just proceeding to study the limit, we should choose the scaling of this parameter rho in such a way that non-trivial limit exists. Yeah. Okay, yes, thank you for this question. Just we stop at minimal order, which will give non-trivial result. You will see in a minute why is it so. I will explain this in the end of my talk. I would say, so now I can say the following thing. So we can go till higher orders as far as you want, but simultaneously we should take D larger and larger, the dimension of the torus. For dimension of the torus more than or equal to 2, we can take only till this order. Yeah. Yes, I take square of. Yes. I miss some terms here. I mean, if you take the whole expansion, if you take the whole expansion, then you compute formally the square of this series. Then in this and in this term, you will have some additional terms. But in fact, they change absolutely nothing. So I can add them there, and nothing will change. So that's okay. Good. So my next goal is to choose a scaling for rho. Scaling for rho. To this end, I need to estimate the terms ns1, 2, 3, and 4. So ns0, this is just the absolute value of vs0 squared. But what is vs0? vs0 is solution of the linear equation. This just Gaussian process, and this is of order 1, of course. So this guy is of order 1. Then simple computation shows that ns1 just equals to zero. And this is the reason why we cannot take only these two guys. So this will be just trivial. This will be linear equation. concerning ns2, we have theorem. ns2 behaves as nu. So we can just find ns2 explicitly, because here we can find all the terms explicitly. I mean, higher term is more involved with computation, but for ns2 is, it is still reasonable. And then it turns out that it's possible to find the asymptotics of ns2 under this limit. And asymptotically, it behaves as new. Asymptotically, it behaves as new. And in S3 and S4, they are bounded by nu squared. So it means that the only reasonable scaling is rho should behave as nu to the power minus 1/2. And that's why we take rho equal to square root of epsilon nu to the power minus 1/2. And here epsilon, this is just a small but fixed number. So it will not go to zero simultaneously with nu or something like that. This is just fixed. So rho is a large parameter because nu goes to zero. Why is it so? Indeed, look, if we take such scaling, then this term will have size just epsilon. This term will have size just epsilon squared. And this term, in fact, it also can be bounded by epsilon squared because you'll have here epsilon 3/2 and you'll have some additional power of nu, and nu is small, so you can bound it by epsilon squared. So in this quasi-energy spectrum, the main non-trivial input gives this second term NS2. And this term, they will be smaller, they will be just given error. So, and in fact, our goal is to show somehow that this term is governed by the wave kinetic equation. So in particular, this energy spectrum represents in such form. So NS equals to NS0 plus epsilon times some NS1, which depends on epsilon. But he is of order 1, and this one is of order 1. So this one is given by these three terms multiplied by nu to the power minus 1. So, and the guy of order 1, this will be this one. Okay. What is the time now? Already 40 minutes passed. So let me say just a couple of words about the proof of the theorem. I have written here some formulas, but I will not enter into details. The first issue is to prove that NS2 asymptotically behaves as nu. To this end, we just write what is NS2. This is expectation of the epsilon squared of VS1 and some another term. Formulas for NS3 and NS4 are more complicated. I do not write them down. We can just inductively compute VS0. VS0, we know that this is a Gaussian process because it's a solution of linear equation. VS1 and then we can compute VS2. Here, I, for example, just wrote down a formula for almost VS1, but I called it AS1 because it is VS1, which is slightly modified. Just I didn't tell you that, in fact, we do not work in these V variables. We work in the so-called interaction representation, which is much more convenient for this subject. But since I do not enter into details of the proofs, I just use it only one time. So I will briefly explain what is this, and then I will forget about this variable, this interaction representation. So interaction representation, these are variables AS of tau, which are obtained by rotation from the variable VS. And the point here is that when you pass to these variables, you just kill this large term in your equation, but instead you get some additional fast rotating term in this equation. In the nonlinearity. Okay, so here I wrote down this A1. Then to compute, for example, this term, we should have something like product, something like squared absolute value of this guy, and then we should take the expectation. So you see here you have summation over ZDL, then you have L to some negative power, and in the result, after taking the expectation, you'll get sums of such form, some sums of S1, in this particular case, this will be k equal to 2. So sum over S1, S2, and L to the power minus 2d. And you approximate it by integrals. And this is the only place, in fact, where we use that L is sufficiently large. We approximate all sums by the integrals, and this is the k for the further developments. But this is the only place where we use that L is large. And then we represent these terms after approximating the sums by the integrals as such singular integrals. Look, here you have some nice function, for example, some Schwarz function in the denominator, but in the denominator you have some non-degenerate quadratic form plus nu squared, some function which is separated from zero, and it turns out that it's possible to find asymptotics of such integrals. This is not trivial. Some nice geometries is inside of this proof, and it turns out that these integrals they're of the size nu, and in fact the asymptotics can be written down just explicitly, and it is given by integration over the manifold where this quadratic form equals to zero. Of course, because otherwise you see that if this quadratic form is not zero, then the denominator is of order one, and the integral is of order nu squared. But the answer is that it is in fact of order nu. That is because the integration of the manifold where this quadratic form degenerates. Well, so now this was about the proof of this theorem, and now we know the scaling for rho, and we can study the energy spectrum of quasi-solution NS. And we'll prove that it converges to, that it's approximately governed by the wave kinetic equation. And to formulate the result, I should define what is the wave kinetic equation precisely. To this end, I need to define the wave kinetic integral. So let x be a real function on Rd. Then the wave kinetic integral is the following integral. So what do we have here? I recall that gamma is a trace of dissipation. Here it is. Here we have like a sum of four integrals in which we have degree 3. And this comes from the fact that nonlinearity has degree 3. And we have some denominator, and the integration is performed over the surface where such equation equals to 0. And here there is S3. Here there is no S3. That's because S3 should be expressed through S1, S2, and S in such a way. So to understand where from this expression comes, just look at this delta prime. That's exactly what is written here. And equality to zero of this expression, this is exactly what I have just told about the fact that asymptotics of integrals we study here is given by integrating over the set where this quadratic form vanishes. Because in fact, when we deduce this kinetic equation, this relies also on analysis of such integrals, and the quadratic form is exactly this one. And we call it the resonance surface. Why? Just because when you pass from this A variable, this V variables to this interaction representation, you will get here fast rotating term, and the fast rotation will be given. So you will have here term e to the power I e to the power minus 1, and then let me call it omega 1, 2, 3 s. And omega 1, 2, 3 s, this is exactly what is written here. So we keep, in the wave kinetic equation, we fill only these resonant frequencies. So wave kinetic integral possesses some nice properties. I will not speak about them. just as an example, if x is a Schwarz function, then k of x also is a Schwarz function. So what is the wave kinetic equation? This equation of such form here, I write m, not n, just because I will denote the solutions by m. So m dot equals to epsilon. Epsilon, this is this epsilon, times the kinetic integral minus the trace of viscosity plus the trace of the noise. And the initial conditions are the same as for our system. Theorem, wave kinetic equation is well posed. I do not speak in which sense to save time. And its solution takes the following form. So we have solution of linear equation plus epsilon, plus error of order epsilon. So let me write it down here. M s of tau equal to m0 s of tau plus epsilon ms1 of tau epsilon. Of course, ms0 of tau, if you compute it, you will just find that it equals to ns0, which is the same that in the energy spectrum. And the main result, the first main result, is the following. To compare our energy spectrum of our quasi-solution, we should extend it to a function on Rd, because for the moment it's defined only on Zdl. It can be done naturally, and it becomes a Schwarz function of Rd. And then theorem that if we fix any r, if epsilon is sufficiently small, then supremum here we have some growing with s if r is positive factor, and then the difference of solution of the wave kinetic equation minus the energy spectrum is less than is bounded by epsilon squared. And look, but we have that the non-trivial term of the energy spectrum is of the size epsilon, and non-trivial term, I mean, the term which fills non-linearity of the wave kinetic equation is also of the size epsilon, but their difference is of the size epsilon squared, So it means that indeed the solution of the wave kinetic equation approximate the energy spectrum of the quasi-solution. And this holds for any time. Provided that nu is sufficiently small, and we remember that L should be large. That's a good question. We do not know. The problem that is we do not know. So we would like, of course, the next thing we would like to do is to prove that the quasi-solution is close to the solution, and then to prove similar result for the solution. But we could, yes. So physicists, they. And below, in a minute, I will show some reasons why it can be not true. But physicists, they always consider a quasi-solution. Anything? No, nothing. We do not know anything about solutions. We speak only about quasi-solutions and about higher-order terms of formal series, and it will come now. So this is the theorem for the quasi-solutions. Well, about the proof of the theorem, I will say almost nothing. Just the only thing that I want to tell is that this theorem, this previous theorem, is indeed in the heart of the proof of our main result, because in order to get the main result, we just analyze the increments in time of this energy spectrum and compare them with the increments in time of the wave kinetic equation. And there, when you're computing the increments in time of the energy spectrum, you should compute the asymptotics of the integrals of such forms that I explained before. So now let us go back to the formal decomposition, which is not truncated. So before I considered only truncation up to order 2, and now I consider the whole formal decomposition. And let us consider the corresponding energy spectrum, which I also compute formally from this decomposition. And we would like to study the higher order terms of in this series. Of course, we would like to prove that the series converges and that this approximates well the solution, that the series is asymptotic. But let me show that what we can prove. So here, NS0 is, before I wrote in quite imprecise way, I just forgot completely the dependence of S. I, for example, wrote that NS2 is just of the size nu. But in fact, everything which we consider, these are fast decaying functions. And below, by S sharp, I will denote various Schwarz functions. So what's important here is that they are fast decaying. So then, as before, NS0 is some Schwarz function. So NS0 is the same that for quasi solution, for of course. Then NS1 is still zero. NS2 is also the same. NS3, NS4, how it was noted, they are slightly different from NS3, NS4 there, but they still satisfy the same estimate. By the way, about this estimate, I didn't tell anything before about this, but we do not know to compute asymptotics for them. We know to compute asymptotic only for NS2. For these guys, we can get only this estimate. For example, for NS4, if you want to do this by hands, you have to estimate like about 20 integrals. Each integral, this takes about 2 pages. So it's something terrible. And you use a kind of stationary phase method there. But this estimate we deduce from the following result, which I will mention in a minute. So assuming that we know this, it's natural to suppose that it's natural to assume that NSK is bounded by nu to the power k over 2. Look, indeed, if this is so, then when I consider a term number k of my formal series for the energy spectrum, rho, of course, should be the same as before. So it's epsilon to the power k over 2, nu to the power minus k over 2. And if this estimate is satisfied, then we have here also nu to the power k over 2. And this means that terms of our formal series, they decay as a power of epsilon. So the formal series, this is a good formal series, which is uniform with respect to nu. But if this estimate is not satisfied, then it means that just the terms of our formal series, they explode when nu goes to 0. And if they explode, it's hard to believe that just the series cannot be asymptotic. And it's hard to believe that the solution, which should be given by some of the series, satisfies the prediction of the wave turbulence that is a similar theorem. So we indeed need to prove this estimate to believe in the prediction of the wave turbulence. And moreover, if this estimate is satisfied, Alberto, it's your question, then we can consider any truncation, any order truncation of this series, and it will satisfy our theorem. It will satisfy our theorem because the higher order terms will give input of just smaller order in epsilon. Trying to prove this estimate, we get the following theorem, which is our second main result. You see, we have this fast decaying factor in S. then we have even slightly better than nu to the power k over 2, which is in accordance with this estimate for 3 here, because we have this. If k equals to 3, then here you have 2, like here, not 3 over half like here. But we have maximum with nu to the power d. It means that we can consider higher order truncation of the series only if d is sufficiently large. And d should be larger, larger, and larger if you want to consider high and higher order truncation of the series. Here in this estimate, we should assume that L grows sufficiently fast, namely this thing is less than the right-hand side of this inequality. But for us, if L goes to infinity fast, it's OK. I mean, it doesn't pose problems. So the question is, if this estimate is optimal, maybe just we didn't manage to, maybe it's a problem of our techniques that we didn't manage to prove this estimate. So trying to understand if this estimate optimal or not, we prove the following, we get the following result. In fact, when getting estimate for this NSK, the case term of the formal decomposition for the energy spectrum, we represent Aegis NSK as a finite sum which is parameterized by certain diagrams which, following standard notion, standard terminology, we call Feynman diagrams. So this is some finite sum, and this sum is obtained. I mean, it isn't something artificial. It's very, very natural way to parameterize this sum. Maybe if I have time, I will explain what are these Feynman diagrams in a couple of words. Anyway, you have some natural representation as a sum of finite number of terms. And then, each integral, this is just given by each integral ES of F, this is some fast oscillating integral. And when proving the estimate for this NSK from the previous theorem, this one, we just prove it for every integral. We just prove it for every integral. But then, for k large, that is k more than 2d, in this case here, maximum is attained on nu to the power d. So this is a bad case. This is a bad case. We find for each k some subsets of the sets of all Feynman diagrams such that the integrals from these subsets, they are indeed of the size nu to the power d. So they are large. They are large. So it means that this estimate cannot be improved. And these integrals, they seem to be of really different nature, so there is no reason to have some conciliation inside. We just wanted to check that there is no conciliations. Of course, we found conciliations. Then we understood that it's a general situation. If you take a sum over this set of like big Feynman diagrams, then you obtain that it is bounded by nu to the power k over 2, exactly what we need. But in fact, we get even better estimate. So this does not contradict to our desired estimate, which I recall NSK less or equal than nu to the power k over 2. But it doesn't give positive answer because this set, it doesn't say that this estimate is true because this set of diagrams is very special. We just can treat it by hands. For other diagrams, we strongly believe that also there are large diagrams, maybe slightly smaller, but still large, which do not satisfy the desired estimates. But also there are some constellations, but we do not know how far do they go. So I mean, so you see, we do not know if this estimate which you want to prove is true or not. And it seems, due to this theorem, that this question is at least non-trivial. And these constellations, they aren't some stupid constellations, like you have integral with plus integral with minus, which gives 0. They are not pairwise. And also, these are constellations only in a few several terms of the decomposition of the sum is new. So this isn't just zero. So that's what we know. So our next goal, of course, is to try to prove that the solution, that nevertheless the series, this quasi-solution approximates the real solution, and to prove our first theorem for the solution, otherwise to find a model for which it is so. Because the techniques we develop, we believe that it can be applied to different models as well. Let me say a couple of words about the proof of the solution. I think that I have like 3 minutes more, because we started 3 minutes later. So the first thing you should do, you should define Feynman diagrams in a convenient way. What are the Feynman diagrams? It's just quite a simple thing. When you compute the terms of this series, first you find VS0. This is just Gaussian process, which is solution of the linear equation. Then you find VS1. And when you are computing VS1, you have equation in which you have here VS1, here VS1, here VS1, and here you'll have 3 times VS0 because you collect terms which are multiplied by rho to the power 1. And so on and so forth. And then, for example, for VS2, in this term you will have several possibilities. Here you have VS1, VS1, VS0. Another one here you have VS2, VS0, VS0. So it's convenient to represent these different possibilities in the following way. VS2, for example, you have several trees. One is VS1, VS1, VS0. Another one is VS2, VS0, VS0. Here we have bar. And so on and so forth. So and then when you compute your energy spectrum, you should multiply Vs by Vs bar, and you take like a product of these trees, and then you should couple these trees via their leaves, because their leaves is a Gaussian processes. And when you take the expectation, like you apply a weak formula, and then you should couple these trees via their leaves. And it turns out that these trees can be defined in a convenient way, which we believe is quite non-standard. In such a way, I mean, we add some additional vertex in these trees, which corresponds to this delta, which doesn't exist in the tree. And it turns out that this is a very convenient language. And just looking attentively at these trees, you can find coordinates in which the integrals, these integrals ESF, take just explicit and nice form. Because in general, if you work in initial coordinates, you have some terrible summations, which are subject to number of linear relations due to these deltas. But looking at the diagrams, you can find the coordinates in which they take such form. And the point is that just this fast oscillating, this fast frequency is just linear in L, which is in fact time, and quadratic in Z. Z, this is the SI where we changed coordinates. And it turns out that these integrals can be analyzed by a kind of like method which is inspired by the stationary phase method. The difficulty is that the phase function here degenerates, and this is bad for the stationary phase method. But nevertheless, we get just for these integrals in some general settings this estimate. So thank you. I think that's all I wanted to tell you.